Around the world, artists are using digital technology to speak their mind. These artists show us that a physical studio is not needed, using the virtual world to question the reality we live in. As part of POWERPLAY, an exhibition championing the African digital art scene, we will explore how these artists create. These are some of their desktops.
So hi, I'm Kumbirai. I'm a digital artist based in London. And my practice mainly involves working with digital software, mainly 3D software. At the moment, I would describe my practice as an exploration of the symbiotic relationship between the material and the digital. I never really thought about my relationship to the digital, but then I realized after a while that I've always been closely interlinked with it in terms of me being interested in gaming software and games at a young age without realizing it. I was obsessed with Pokemon, I was obsessed with Dragon Ball Z. I loved The Sims. I remember I had Sims 1, I had Sims 2, I had Sims 3. I spent hours on it. And I think this immersion into these digital spaces is something I never questioned up until like 2 years ago, where I'm like looking at myself now, that totally makes sense back then. I feel like I'm easily classified as a digital artist because I mainly use digital software. I like to class myself in a way as like a shapeshifter in terms of my artistic practice. I would say I'm a research-based artist that uses a lot of digital equipment and digital software in the way in which I make my work. I feel like from the way that I talk about my work with a lot of people, I think very romantically about my practice. But I think for me, it was the fact that I really just wanted to sit down and like explore and really think about what the structure of my practice is. How do I work? What do I like engaging with? I just wanted to be able to have the space to kind of just articulate that without having financial demands like playing in my mind. So I actually moved back home to Sheffield and I got a studio at S1 Art Space. And for a few months, I was just working on a project, which is now POWERPLAY. I lived in Baton over here, and I used to catch a bus to Sheffield if I wanted to go to Sheffield. But I think for me, I'm only really just start. I think when I moved back to Sheffield to get my studio, it was the first time that I actually started to understand the city. And I feel like with where I was from, there was quite a few creative people, but I was just surrounded by people into performing arts and not so much fine arts. I thought that was something I kind of had to explore by myself. So yeah, I used to go to Sight Gallery and it was really cute because they used to have this cute bookshop. And that's where I started to discover publications like Printed Pages. I really wanted to see the artists I was seeing on Instagram because I feel like I followed a lot of people in London and who'd be going to like Saatchi or they'd be going to Tate. And I feel like I was looking for that kind of thing in Sheffield and I wasn't getting that. But I think Sight Gallery was a close second to that. I was born in Chiredzi in Zimbabwe, which is near where my mum was born. My mum has a story, well, my parents have a story about once they were there and some hippos started a stampede and my parents got really scared and they ran away and accidentally left me. Luckily, I was fine. It's a place that I've been, I was born there. I was there until 4. It feels like a place that has my heart, but I've never been able to go there and explore it in my adulthood and kind of get to understand it by myself. I feel like I still only know it through stories. I feel like I need to go there and kind of demystify the idea of it in my head still to this day. I think it felt like fate. It sounds really funny because I feel like at that time within my research, I was starting to really go back to my heritage and things that I found interesting about Zimbabwe. With conversations happening right now, specifically to like colonialism, I feel like I've been delving even further into that. This opportunity to then exhibit there, it just felt like a bigger connection between my practice and the way I'd be exhibiting. So it felt like a godsend, actually. I've always been interested in type. So as I was trying to find a font to use for my dissertation, I found out about these phonetic symbols that were used in the standardization of the Shona language, which is the language that me and my parents speak. And I think in a way they were very hegemonic. And he created these symbols to make sounds that weren't in the English language, but they were actually rejected. And so basically they had to then create combinations of letters to make these sounds. And I think through this, I kind of started looking at symbols and type and how they could be used to essentially bring back these things that were rejected and archived back into public dissemination. And I think it was through that that it led me to start working with symbols, which is shown here in one of the works in PowerPlay. My exploration of symbols kind of came about because I started looking at the way in which symbols can just be more than graphical and how they can be activated, which then also led me to my exploration of alchemy as well. The rug actually depicts a transmutation circle. So after watching Fullmetal Alchemist, which is an incredible show, it really affected me. I was really interested in alchemy and finding out like what its origins are within real life. It was like magical but scientific at the same time, and I kind of loved that relationship. I talk about this ascension of the human body, so basically the transformation of the human consciousness into code, and I kind of went back to alchemy because it's just that whole from like one state to another. So in terms of a rug, I thought about if I was going to be in a space and I essentially wanted to be a part of the transmutation, how would I present that in a space? And I didn't want to put vinyl on the floor because I thought it just wouldn't be helpful. I wanted something that would be strong and have an authority to it to an extent. That whole idea of equivalent exchange, I was looking at my work. And in the show, the whole thing of like dabbling with life in relation to transmutation circles, there's life at the beginning and there's life at the end, which is kind of like a loophole in a sense. I think what I advocate within the whole work is cyborgism and this whole idea of not seeing technology or nature as absolutes where one or the other will prevail, but maybe the two need to come together and maybe the combination will take us forward. Technology isn't the end, but it could be the means to an end. This work, it's called kumbirai@gmail.com. is probably where it all started. I started off by using this program called Adobe Fuse to make 3D models, which I would then experiment with. And it was through this experimentation that I kind of really ended up not liking these models, also due to the fact that they were very limited models. There wasn't too much you could experiment with them. That partnered up with my explorations of blackness. I just found these objects to be generic pre-made models of black bodies that weren't fluid, they weren't diverse, they were very monolithic, and I hated that. Just me being able to get all of these ideas together about things that I didn't like and finding the manifestation within real life, within culture. It was essentially just a way to find a voice that I couldn't use at the time, but I think it was like using things that already existed. Basically, the work in itself discusses the perception of blackness as one-dimensional. And whenever I started talking about it, people wouldn't really understand what I was saying. But once I found these clips of people talking in relation to this perception of blackness as one-dimensional, and people talking from that perspective, people thinking from that perspective, I think I was able to speak without actually opening my mouth. Throughout my whole practice, I feel like I'm very polite and I'm very, usually I'm very polite. I'm also very wary of the things that I say because I couldn't discuss it properly. I found ways of speaking without actually speaking. I think the work literally just speaks for itself. For example, when I now have this conversation around the perception of blackness as one-dimensional, I don't even discuss it anymore. I just tell people to look at this work. So the work is actually a proposal for people to send me an email about being able to talk about this, because I was kind of thinking, wait, if I'm in this position, surely there's someone else that wants to talk about this. And basically, apparently there was supposed to be a lesbian storyline within Black Panther, and it was axed. It never actually got made, which I found really interesting. If you're portraying this Black society, which is technologically advanced ahead of its time, yet they still don't believe in they're still not presenting homosexuality. There's a really interesting relation between blackness and queerness that I wanted to also highlight within the work. Yeah, I would literally just like record myself in spaces and just insert objects into them. And there was something about it that I just find really interesting and otherworldly. That aspect of the fantastical is something that runs throughout my work constantly. So this work is called Immersion for Zining. And this is what I actually made for my final major project when I was at university. And it's essentially an interactive experience. I just wanted to essentially design the experience of research. I basically collected a huge body of research surrounding the act of caring. And it basically included artist notes, included quotes from practitioners I'd interviewed. It was sometimes calm. It was confusing, disorientating, yet beautiful at the same time as the whole experience of it. And I want to design that in experience. And I feel like this is interesting because I created a world that was fully immersive in the sense that there was no relationship between the outside and the inside within this. This was solely about creating a world which you could get lost in and dissociate into. I feel like the process is kind of the work in itself. I think for me, what I'm trying to say through my work constantly changes, but I feel like the demand to want to say something, I think it comes from me being someone that's quite, like I said, I'm quite polite. I feel like I'm very wary of the things that I say. So I feel like maybe I feel like I read quite a lot. I don't want to challenge these people, or I don't want to offend anyone with what I want to say without articulating it carefully. And I feel like because I'm so conscious within my practice, I analyze everything and I dissect everything, and I really like to about the tone and the voice that it has. I feel like deserves to be heard even if you don't agree with it. And the character going through ascension has monologues, they kind of shout, there's like points of anger, and I feel like I'm kind of opening up to this idea that I don't have to be polite all the time. I feel like it's something that I'm working through, but I think that this idea of offense, I feel like there's offense and there's also things that are perceived as offensive because of the truth, and some people aren't willing to take the accountability to accept those truths. So basically throughout my practice, I'm interested in these silver objects that I use using the metaball deformer. I've come to kind of use it to create abstract shapes that which I have slight control over, but not at the same time. And I kind of like the idea of not having complete control over the outcome, but kind of letting the tools that you use kind of guide you in how you make the work, in the sense that through its calculations and its randomness, you kind of end up with something that's both a mixture of you and the software. Usually they're very heavily constructed in the sense that I have to really think about how everything is placed. So for example, let me just try and take everything out so you can see what it actually looks like outside of the deformer. When I make symbols, sometimes I literally just throw ink around on the floor, and then I'll trace over the ink with patterns that I find really interesting. And then within those patterns, I'll then sometimes get perfect forms that resemble things, but sometimes I get things like this, which then I can then attach to create things that are more distinguishable. So for example, those experiments then lead to me being able to create characters out of them to create languages. The thing that I kind of wanted to highlight mainly was this idea of ascension, maybe existing virtually, could essentially give us the information that we need to then bring that back to the physical world and then make the physical existence better. I wanted something that you got lost in the sense that you were literally enraptured by a mood. It was all of these things that you see today. Maybe if someone could completely leave and exist in a space where they can think clearly and look from an external perspective, maybe they could come back and help, and maybe the whole process of ascension itself is a gate. So basically, yeah, I thought that the gate would be there. Imagine if that was to then be activated, then someone could just pass through and it'd be here. And I feel like within the work, I kind of emphasize that this person of ascension is not through mind transfer or with the way that they've conceptualized how one would become code in terms of like transhumanism theory. I kind of wanted it to be kind of more magical. So basically the whole space is a reimagining of Great Zimbabwe. It's like a ruined stone city. Well, not stone city, stone kingdom in Zimbabwe. And it's essentially like a lost civilization. Could that type of living be a gate to a new way of being in terms of how we be living, how we sustain ourselves in terms of multiple, in a multifaceted way? The character is simulating this site specifically. The idea of like gates in relation to threshold concepts is something that will probably stick with me, but I think the physical manifestation of, or a physical manifestation of a gate within power is something that's probably just going to stay within power play. When I describe my practice to my parents, they have no clue what I'm doing. So I was thinking about how this process of ascension is somewhat magical. My parents are highly spiritual people, and I know that a lot of my family are, with which I came to understand that my parents had like a history with ancestral worship that I didn't even know about. There is this completely technological aspect to it. But I feel like you could really understand and digest the storyline if you could just understand the fact that they're coming from one state to another. I usually write a lot before I make a work, or I use a piece of text that I've written to work. I feel like it really helps to ground a project. It's nice to have something to constantly fall back upon. It acts as like a guide. You have this thing that kind of acts like a Bible to guide you. Or it was a mix of things. I wrote this script. How many pages is this? And it's literally a conversation between two people. And I think it started off as me just trying to write a speech, and then it became a conversation. And then it kind of became a performance, in the sense that I have people speaking. I have sounds that I want to be played. I have, like, even this, like, loading entry 447-14722-24. It kind of becomes like a way of storytelling. I think it kind of comes from my love of science fiction, especially this piece. It's definitely a performativity, and I feel like I kind of hinted at this earlier on, in the sense that I'm so wary of my voice that sometimes I don't want to speak, so I feel like I find voices to speak through. I think there's something so fun about like creating alter egos, or like creating personalities that maybe have traits that I don't have, through which I can then speak through them. I'm not doing this for anyone necessarily, I'm doing this for me, and I want my practice to nurture. I want to do the best for it. I think I literally see it as like an organism that needs maintenance, in the sense that I need to read to maintain it. I need to start working a bit more, working more physically, because I feel like it's craving this thing to help it move forward. Or it wants to go in this direction, let me get the means to go in that direction. It sounds really funny, but I feel like I literally just use the internet to consume. I love going on wiki pages for shows and movies. So not on that page, like, you know how they have like their own like fandom wiki, Lord of the Rings, Game of Thrones, and Neon Genesis. Like, loads of my favorite shows, I love coming here and just reading about it. I just like consuming really interesting ideas. Doing this, or just watching pointless YouTube videos, but I literally just get into YouTube holes. There's no in between. I feel like it's literally this or YouTube. Things stick, some things don't. And consuming doesn't necessarily mean like I have to read a book. Like, it means like I'll watch a show with a really interesting storyline that has very interesting themes, such as, which is usually anime, funnily enough, also science fiction. And I consider that like part of my practice in terms of consuming. My practice shifts with every project. There's like, I need a period to like understand like what's happened, what did I discover, what's the new direction, what is there to take from this experience, like what, and again, kind of like questioning my practice, like where do you go now, like what do you want? Like, I am very interested in the basically a symbiotic relationship between the digital and the physical, and how that can be exploited even further. Over the past year or so, I've realized how like international these scenes are, and how helpful it is once you become international. I feel like I'm getting that chance now, but someone else could be age 30 and still hasn't gotten that chance. Black voices aren't just coming from artists, they're coming from people that want to be curators, they're coming from people that want to be programmers, they're coming from people that want to be directors of galleries, because once they're in there, they can also help to bring more voices into it. And I think it's not about diversity. Diversity is a corporate term, but I think it's more about making sure that everyone's heard.